हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू एनालॉग आईएएस करंट अफेयर एनालिसिस फॉर 9th September 2020 एंड दीस आर द कपल ऑफ आर्टिकल्स विल बी डीलिंग टुडे। दिस आर्टिकल इज टेकन फ्रॉम द हिंदू एंड इट इज टाइटल्ड व्हाट इज इन ए नाम एंड इंडियाज अलाइनमेंट। नाउ रिसेंटली आर एक्सटर्नल अफेयर्स मिनिस्टर एस जयशंकर कमेंटेड दैट इवन दो इंडिया स्टिल रिटेन्स द स्पिरिट ऑफ नॉन अलाइन मूवमेंट, द टर्म नॉन अलाइनमेंट has been in use in a particular context. So this should make it very clear that the stance of the government with respect to the idea of non-alignment has changed, and the fact that non-alignment movement as such is dead right now. But the essential spirit has been retained. Non-alignment movement, the purpose was to have a strategic autonomy. Now obviously in a world that is split between US and USSR, retaining strategic autonomy was a very significant aspiration. The tool that was followed back then was non-alignment. So this tool is no longer achieving the objective that it was supposed to retain, that is strategic autonomy. So we still have this strategic autonomy as the core of our foreign policy basis. But we need to tweak with the system of non-alignment. That is the central premise of this article. Officially, the end of USSR marked the end of Cold War also. So ever since, non-alignment movement has slowly started losing its relevance in a world that has shifted from a multipolar or bipolar world in the Cold War era to a unipolar world that is dominated by USA. And now a multipolar world where you have multiple power centers and a significant threat in the form of China, especially for Indian relevance. So the foreign policy of our country should take into consideration the new developments that are happening across the globe. Now India stands for something called a rules-based world order. Now this rules-based world order requires alignment with multiple countries rather than non-alignment. The conception of non-alignment movement means that it is not ready to engage either with US or USSR. Now, for different strategic reasons, India does have a necessity to associate both with USA and USSR, or now Russia. So, in this context, how are we going to relook at this objective of strategic autonomy, and what are the tools that we have to take into consideration? The first one is the China factor. As we have seen in the COVID pandemic, the aggression shown by China has many countries on the edge of their seats, and that is the reason why they want to counter China, whether it is in the form of Quad that we are talking about or the aggressive stance taken by US. It is because of the behavior of China. So there have been instances where Quad has been looked at as an alternative for Asia-Pacific NATO. But India has clearly reiterated that if India wants to engage with Quad, it looks at Indo-Pacific as an area where it is a geographical entity rather than a strategic entity. So for India, as per the policy outlined by the Prime Minister himself, this is a geographical conception and tries to amalgamate all the relevant littoral states and the countries in the region for sustainable development. So the integration of countries in Indian Ocean rim, or whether we are talking about the other littoral states, and engagement of India with countries like Vanilla Islands and taking them on board in this Indo-Pacific strategy is a case to the point. Now we have to understand that if any country is to be severely affected, that it would be India if we take a NATO-like stance with respect to China. We have to really trust our negotiating partners like USA. In the present scheme of things, USA is dealing with a transactional nature of foreign policy. That is, unless and until USA has certain advantages, it is not offering anything to any country. This is the style of diplomatic engagement that Donald Trump believes in. So Russia engagement is definitely needed for India to balance China. But the problematic factor here is Russia is growing closer to China as well. Therefore, to balance these contradictions, India should never enter into any sort of an alliance as such. It should still retain the spirit of this non-alignment, but change it in a way that it is projected as a multi-alignment. So we have to engage with every partner and not get into a legally binding treaty which says that you should be aligned with only one particular template of scheme of things. So NATO-like scheme of things is a dicey affair when we consider India's foreign policy. So the most important agenda for India's foreign policy is to garner enough support for UNSC reforms. That is the larger agenda we should focus upon, because we believe on a rules-based world order. Now, India can aspire to be a Vishwaguru, that is leading the world by an example, and that can happen only through a rules-based world order and amalgamating responses to these difficult times. That is the gist of this article. This article is taken from the Hindu and it is titled A Case for Down-to-Earth Governance. The bottom line of this article is to emphasize on local governance. Now, why are we emphasizing on local governance? What are the reasons why local governance is the utmost important reformist aspect that we have to focus upon in our Indian polity? That is the focus of this article. Now, before getting to this logical conclusion, let us try to dissect the various aspects that were discussed in this article and link it to our issues associated with the parliamentary form of government. On the basis of a relationship between the executive and the legislature, governments have been divided into two types. One is the parliamentary form of government and the other one is the presidential form of government. India has adopted for a parliamentary form of government. So the adoption of this parliamentary system of government by the Constituent Assembly was more in keeping with the advantages expected to come from the institution of parliament. So what are the advantages that the Constituent Assembly saw at the time of writing this constitution? The first one is familiarity with the form of government, because before the parliament was formed, or the Indian independence movement itself, we have had the British parliament. So Indians were accustomed to that form of governance. But that was not the only factor. There were certain other factors as well. The first one is the framers sought to achieve the objective of unity in the country through the mechanism of the popular government, which is uniting Indians to one mass electorate having universal adult suffrage given in Article 326. The second thing is, states had certain apprehensions about joining the Indian Union at the time of the formation of our Indian Union. So in order to accommodate their concerns, federal structure with a unitary bias was created. Now that can be possible only in a parliamentary form of government which is directly elected by the people. One might ask, why not go for the presidential model? But going in for a presidential model for the sake of a strong executive to ensure the unity and integrity of the nation would have been very dangerous, because what if the president turns very despotic? There should be checks and balances, right? So the parliament provided that checks and balances through the parliamentary form of government. Now, last, the institution of parliament was probably the only operational guarantee which the framers could think of. Every other thing is impractical. And the last reason was the accommodation of diversity of our country. So we have representation in our parliament of all the regions across the country. So this was the rationale behind choosing the parliamentary form of government. If we take a critical view of the working of the parliament, the performance of parliament has been on decline for the last few decades, especially marked by unruly behavior where MPs fight against each other. The rise of criminalization of politics as a phenomenon has been taking a front seat whenever we're talking about electoral politics. The party system, which was supposed to give a direction for the ideology, Now, a lot of parties came into existence and the coalition governments have been breaking down the governance structures. Otherwise, there is a dominance of one single party and there is no strong opposition. So these are some of the commonly noticed issues. But what are the larger issues that we are talking about? What is the design problem as such? And how we have addressed this design situation already, but we are not implementing it on the paper. Now, what is the design situation that we are talking about? The first one being that of corruption. Now, whenever we are talking about politics, corruption is usually associated with it. As a response to this corruption, in 2010-2011, the Jan Andolan movement or India Against Corruption movement started for creation of Jan Lokpal, a body which has the power to take into consideration the corruption charges against even the highest individuals like Prime Minister. Now, Mr. Anna Hazare, who was leading this movement, commented one interesting thing. The creation of Jan Lokpal itself will not be enough and it requires electoral reforms as well as decentralization of power. Now, it is in this context we have to take into consideration the importance of local governance. But before that, let us talk about electoral politics. Whenever we talk about electoral politics, we have to understand that money is an indispensable part of election campaign. Now, one might argue that if we actually don't take money for voting, which is an illegal thing to do, if voters are very honest, then this problem would be solved. But that is an oversimplified version of the understanding of the electoral campaign. Say, take the example of the American election that is happening right now. Despite spending not even a single penny on bribing the voters, the election campaign cost touched millions of dollars for each of the candidate. One might wonder what is the cost involved. The most important aspect of any campaign is to reach out to people and carry out communications. Now, media is very central to that aspect, and there are three different varieties of media that is making it possible for the candidates to reach out to the population. Now, any candidate cannot ignore either of this media. Take the example of social media. For example, you have Facebook, you have Twitter, you have Instagram, you have various other mediums like YouTube as well. Now, electoral campaigns are like a race. You have to attract the voters and bombard them with the content on each of these platforms, and it requires certain amount of money. This aspect has also been a part of the debate because certain companies like Facebook have been alleged that they are favoring one sort of the campaign because they are getting more money. Now, the traditional electronic media, which is considered to be one of the widest form of media which can reach out to the common public, is a traditional cost that is involved. The other thing is print media, even though relatively it is declining, it is still relevant, especially in rural areas in country like us. So let us look at the second aspect. Say, for example, a candidate has eventually won and he is finally entering into the parliament. Now, can he really focus on the national issues? Say, for example, if a candidate is elected from a southern state like Karnataka or Tamil Nadu, which have certain local issues. Now, as a representative of the parliament, he is expected to voice the concerns of the local population at a national level. Now, where is the thin line between the national agenda, that is the country as a whole, and the local agenda? If a particular party has a lot of seats from a state, there is every possibility that that particular state ministers or MPs from those states, if they are not ministers, might bargain for a larger share of pie of the development, and that we usually see, especially in the context of railways. The party that is in power will be able to get more and more number of railway lines to their state instead of the requirement and the economic rationale. So things like this happen. So the very design is in conflict. If he focuses on the national issues, he will not be re-elected. But if he is not focusing on the national issues, how are we going to move forward as a nation? How are we going to utilize the knowledge of MPs in nation building? This is the conflict. Now, for all these problems, whether it is corruption, whether it is money, or whether it is the local agenda, Parliament cannot be an answer. A power that is sitting in Delhi and dictating terms to the local level villages is definitely not a solution for this kind of problem. Realizing this, we have arrived at the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, through which local governance became a norm. Yet we are not witnessing the seriousness with which this agenda should be pursued. So the bottom line is, we have to devolve powers to the local government. For local government to function properly, we have given them the power through the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act. But the problem is, they are not uniform. Each states behave in a certain way. And yes, that is intentional, because every state is not uniform, and this uniformity should not be in the form of structure. It should be in the form of standards, minimum standards expected across all the states. Now, the second thing that they need is money. So to garner more financial resources, they should have taxation powers. And the third level that we're talking about is capacity building. That is, the professionals who are working at the local level should be competent enough to handle the local issues. For this, capacity building measures should happen at regular intervals, whether it is to the MLAs who are working with the local representatives, or whether they are local representatives, or even officers who are working at grassroots level. They should be empowered as well. So learning is a prerequisite for continuous development, and when it has to happen at the grassroots level, capacity building is a prerequisite. So the sooner we understand this, the better. And we have to reorient our entire priorities, because if the local governments take care of the local needs, finally the MPs and MLAs will focus on the policy making and work in their respective domains of empowering the state as well as the nation. They will have less things to worry about. That is the gist of this article. That's it for the day. Thank you.